Well, for more analysis on that latest jobs report, especially on how the pandemic has impacted women in the job market, I'm joined now by Emily Golden in New Jersey. She's a master certified coach with a new book just out, The New Golden Rule. Welcome to the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
So first, I want to talk about the uneven effect that COVID has had on women in the labor market. Why is it happening so far, and why so disproportionate?
You know, it's really hard to say the exact reason. My view is that women were being pushed to the brink for a very long time, and this COVID crisis has pushed many women over the edge and had them exit the workforce. Of course, there have been also a tremendous amount of layoffs as well, but we'll get into that a little bit as well.
So talk about some of the things that did push them to the brink. And did women come out any better in January than they did in December?
So the January numbers aren't out. They'll be out next week. This has certainly been a hot topic. So one thing I can say for sure in my industry is that there's a lot of conversation about it, and there's a lot of support being offered for women around what can women do, what can men do for women, and how can we collectively work together to solve for this enormous issue. So some of the things that have women leaving the workforce, well, it's no surprise that women in our culture are really still viewed as the primary caregivers for children. Even though we like to think that we've kind of grown from that and it's more even, women are really in most households, if it's a dual income family, if one partner has to stay home, it's often the wife in a typical traditional family. And so many women have left because they just have to. They have children to take care of, children to educate. Childcare is closed. And this is a huge impact.
So then let's break it down by demographic then. How have African American and Latina women fared during this time?
So African American women and Latino women have been significantly impacted, but not to the extent that Asian women have in terms of the long-term unemployment impact. So Asian American women have been 44% of unemployed Asian American women have been out of work for more than 6 months. And that is greater than any other American group of American women.
And what do you attribute that to?
Well, many Asian American women work in the service sector, including restaurants, leisure, hospitality, retail, and beauty. And of course, other groups work in this industry as well. But there happens to be a high number of Asian Americans in this industry. But that alone is not, in my opinion, the reason that we're seeing this strong negative trend. There's, in my opinion, I believe, and there have been some studies to back it up, there's an anti-Asian racism impact happening. And it's something that if we're being, you know, real and honest, it's having an impact. And it's a problem that we need to be addressing and solving for.
And we certainly did see a lot of that dangerous rhetoric coming from the previous administration and how they characterized the coronavirus. So then what should the U.S. government be doing now on this front versus, say, the private sector?
So I'm not an expert on the government side, and yet there is so much that the government can be doing to support us. Let's focus on childcare, right? It impacts women more than men, whether we like to admit it or not. We live in a culture that, by and large, the primary child-rearing responsibilities fall on mom. So universal free childcare is being batted around and talked about in many circles. It's being asked of the government by many, many groups. In my opinion, it would revolutionize our workforce and make both men and women able to be more productive, for those that have left the workforce, be able to re-enter, and those that are in the labor market stay in the labor market. And the new administration is absolutely, there's evidence that there's a lot of effort being made in this way. The Biden's $1.9 trillion COVID-19 relief proposal includes a lot of support and relief for women and for the workforce in general.
And so adding to that then, talk about some of these women executives and other women who are calling for a Marshall Plan for mums. What is it they're asking for? How much of a difference could it make? And how likely is it to actually go through?
Well, I will start with the last and say, I don't know how likely it is, but Reshma Soojani, founder and CEO of Girls Who Code, is calling on Biden to create a Marshall Plan for moms. She has 50 prominent female actors, activists, and CEOs who signed a letter that was published in the New York Times urging Biden to address the fact that 2 million of us, 2 million women, have left the workforce at a rate 4 times that of men in September of 2020 alone. And I'll tell you a little bit about what's in that plan. But what I have to say about this as a coach is, yes, this is leadership. These female executives are modeling the type of courageous and bold leadership that I talk about in my book, The New Golden Rule. And I stand behind this demand for what might seem like a drastic measure, but if ever there was a time for it, it's now. This economic downturn is being called by working moms a she-session, not a recession. We are impacted so significantly.
And Emily, I'm sorry, because I don't want us to run out of time before you go through some of the points. If you could just quickly run through some of the top points from that Marshall Plan.
So the Marshall Plan would include short-term monthly spending for childcare, child tax credits, stimulus payments, unemployment benefits, funding for school, paid leave, and raising the minimum wage. The paid childcare is, you know, one of the big topics in this Marshall Plan that's getting a lot of attention.